Okay. Mr. Secretary General Yves Leterme, distinguished guests, dear students, dear colleagues, the topic of today's debate is vast and vital. And by organizing this public conference, the Institute for European Studies, in collaboration with the Centre d'études de la vie politique and the International Institute for Democracy and Electoral Assistance, International IDEA, have sought to bring together academics, students, experts, and policy actors to discuss about the challenges of democracy and its future. Democracy is an ideal. It is a form of government and the political concepts which imply free press, independent judiciary, and the system of check and balances on leaders through free elections and separation of power among the branches of government. But as you know, because you are students in political science, this is a minimal definition of democracy. As political scientists, you know that democracy is about more than elections. That a good democracy can be said to be one that presents a stable institutional structure that realizes the liberty and equality of citizens through the legitimate and correct functioning of its institutions and mechanisms. A good democracy is not only a broadly legitimate regime, but also one which completely satisfies its citizens. We also know that the ideals of democracy are appealing to citizens around the world. Since the 70s, the number of democratic regimes increased, while the number of autocracies was cut by 2/3. Today, every country in the world virtually proclaims itself to be a democracy. Nevertheless, in recent years, much of this progress seems to be eroded. The number of countries falling into a gray zone between democracy and autocracy is rising, and there are also countries in the world that are at risk of becoming non-democracies. Recent developments show us that there are two different things to establish a democratic political regime and to preserve it. We also know that the state of democracy is also deteriorating in Europe. The challenges to democracy are particularly complex, and they take different forms at the European and domestic level. And what we see is the increasing gap between citizens and political parties, that mainstream political parties are losing ground, that populist parties are now in power, and that they promote institutional reforms that undermine the quality of democracy, that inequality is widespread, and also this inequality affects citizens' political and social rights. Values are at risk, and when I'm talking about values, I refer to equity, to fairness, and solidarity. Of course, the topic of this conference is a matter of concern for all of us. As political scientists, but also as lawyers, we seek to understand current problems of democracy. We provide definitions and we produce analysis on different dimensions of this concept of democracy. But there are other questions, there are normative questions that need to be addressed, like, for example, how to bring fresh energy into politics that could benefit democracy, how to reduce the gap, if this gap has to be reduced, how to reduce the gap between the citizens and the elites. And we think that to answer these questions, the dialogue with political actors and experts is fundamental. Of course, as professors in political science and also in European law, we encourage our students to read and to listen, but also to be attentive observers of the transformations of our time, to be curious and also to raise good questions. So in order to have this debate on this very timely and topical issue, we have the honor and privilege to welcome today the Secretary General of the Stockholm-based intergovernmental organization International IDEA, the Institute for Democracy and Electoral Assistance, Mr. Yves Leterme, to share with us his view and insights about the challenges of democracy and its future. There are challenges, but there are also opportunities, and we look forward, Mr. Secretary General, to discuss them with you. How does IDEA seek to overcome these challenges, and how does it seek to seize new opportunities. For the audience and for the students, IDEA is one of the international actors championing the cause of democracy in the world. IDEA plays a crucial role to support sustainable democratic change through providing comparative knowledge and assisting in democratic reforms and influences also policies and politics. And IDEA also captures diverse experiences of democracy in different parts of the world. The mission of the Secretary General of IDEA is to provide strategic leadership for the Institute to report on the overall implementation activities and also to develop strong relations with member states and other constituencies. Of course, Yves Leterme is well known by the audience, but I would like to remind Mr. Leterme your main responsibilities at the domestic level as Prime Minister of Belgium, at the international level as Deputy Secretary General of the Organization for Economic Cooperation and Development in Paris, and as Minister at different levels, at the regional and national level, involved in the policy making at the European level, in the Council and European Council. So we would like to thank you very much for being here today and for giving us a bit of vision and insights on the challenges of democracy. We are most honored by your presence, and we really look forward to listen to your lecture. Before giving you the floor, just 1 minute, I would like, on behalf of the president of the Institute for European Studies, Anne Weyenberg, and Emily Van Oot, deputy director of the CEVIPOL, and Professor Nathalie Brack, to express our gratitude to the IDEA Brussels office team and its director, Andrew Bradley, who contributed to the organization of this event. We really look forward to more dialogue and increased cooperation between our institutes. Et nos remerciements les plus sincères s'adressent aussi à toute l'équipe de l'Institut d'études européennes qui a organisé cet événement, Alexia Samuel, Pierre Vierzet et Françoise Vandenbroek. Dear students, dear colleagues, please give your full attention to the Secretary General of the IDEA, Mr. Yves Leterme.
Merci beaucoup. Thank you very much, Professor. Tout d'abord, uitleggen waarom Engels spreken is, omdat dat een taal is, denk ik, qui est connue par la plupart des personnes ici, et que c'est la langue véhiculaire. It's the official language of international ID, and I think this is the best way to handle the language-linked issue of this lecture. From a practical point of view, I would propose that I take 40 minutes, something like that, 45 minutes, to go through some ideas and some visions we have on the what's currently happening in the developed democracies all over the globe, on the concept of democracy, and that then I stand open for questions which you would assume that I could give an answer to. Let me first of all say that I'm a bit stressed and nervous because I speak here under the scrutiny of a predecessor. International ID has had 4 secretary generals until now. I'm the 4th, I think, and Karin Fogg was the number 2. So the fact that you sit in the room, Karin, gives me a bit of stress. And secondly, of course, Director Andrew Bradley, joined by Gosia and Madeline. I don't know where they are sitting, but they are outside. Okay. Well, this is always another challenge. The last but not least challenge is that, of course, the recent developments in the field of democracy, be it from a societal point of view or institutional point of view, is a very vast domain. And so to summarize some thoughts and visions in 40 minutes, even 40 minutes, three-quarter of an hour, is, of course, a very difficult to achieve, successfully achieve challenge. But nevertheless, let's start. The state of democracy. Very important for our approach, both in our research and in the programs we have in and activities in 71 countries, very important is to agree on what we call a kind of container concept. We tend to say that democracy can only be supported and never exported, and that democracy comes in all kinds of forms and ways and setups. And that's the reason why we have a definition that is quite broad, where you can make fitting in all kinds of systems that have elections, that have representation, that have equality amongst the citizens. These are the two, in fact, two main parts of the definition. So democracy, to our opinion, is a system of governance in which the government is controlled by the people, so the issue of control by the people, and then the second one, and in which citizens are considered equals in the exercise of that control. So it's both parts. It's control of the exercise of public authority, of governance, control by the people. But number two, and this is maybe more a quality-related issue aspect, it's also a system where there is a guarantee for the equality of the citizens in the exercise of that control. This definition tends to overlap, to comprise, has a potential to comprise all kinds of forms and developments, even in history. But we will see later that there are, of course, different kinds of democracies and different developments. For instance, when we have a look into the literature, we see that at the time of Aristotle, that he tended to write that there were essentially four aspects that were very important when discussing debating the quality of democracy. Number one was the very important issue of the rule by turn and the extent to which all citizens have a stake of interest was a kind of ancient Greek definition of what you would call inclusiveness. The number two, the importance of the middle class. Nothing changes in world history. This is the current debate also. Where is the American middle class? How is the middle class going in Europe? Number three, very importantly, the rule of law. So control by the citizens, equality in that control, but also the rule of law. And last but not least, and this is also referring to a very actual issue, it's the role of education, the essential role of education of young people, of citizens. By the way, last week there was the World Forum organized by the Council of Europe in Strasbourg, a very successful event. We had, I think, something, Andrew, of 1,500 to 2,000 young people that gathered from all over the globe to discuss, mostly young people, to discuss the state of democracy. And the issue there that was discussed, the theme of this year's World Democracy Forum was the role of education. So nothing changes. When we look at current debates, we see that besides the four aspects that were put forward in ancient Greek literature, we see that contemporary aspects, or for instance, the organization of elections, the way elections are organized, the voter turnout, the results, of course, of election, the interaction, the impact of elections on the real exercise of public authority, the kind of policies. Number two, at present time, it's much about the future of the multi-party system, the concept of a political party, where we should always remind ourselves that the concept of a political party is, in fact, like it functions now, is, in fact, quite a recent concept. I always try to summarize in saying that the 20th century was a breakthrough of the real popular political parties. Well, we see that, even not 100 years after the rise of popular political parties, mass parties, that they already are on the brink of collapse, or there is a lot of volatility in the existence of the multi-party system of political parties. Debates today about democracy are much about inclusiveness. Is everyone on board? Think about what Friedman summarized earlier this summer in analyzing the electoral campaign in the States, that it is much about a debate about, on the one hand, the so-called web people, the hyper-connected people, and then the wall people, the people that stand aside and don't feel involved in the current political debate. So inclusiveness is, up to date, a very important issue. Freedom of speech, essential. And the role of media. We have lots of nations worldwide, members of the United Nations, that claim to be democracies and that indeed organize elections. They not always have a multi-party system, but still. But the freedom of speech is limited. And the role of media is really scrutinized very importantly. And so you can say that this is an important aspect also of the quality of democracy. The role of money, just to name another one, vested interest in the United States that managed to change the agenda of priorities through giving donations to candidates, and the Supreme Court that says, well, to donate to a candidate or political party is a form of the freedom of expression, so we shouldn't limit this. So this debate currently, not only in the United States, also in other democracies, is another aspect of democracy that maybe was not fully captured by what Aristoteles wrote about this. Last but not least, of course, and this is very, I think it's for almost the first time in world history, in human history, that we have such a globalized, open globalized world with such an intense interconnectedness, the interconnection through the new tools of the ICT revolution. So these are aspects of the debate that illustrate the vastness when we talk about a state of democracy. And when we start from a broad definition, we see that there are lots of aspects that we should tackle. A development is always two-sided. You have positive developments and you have negative aspects of the current developments. And I will give some of both categories in order to unleash discussion. I won't be exhaustive, but I think I won't be complete, but I think that most of the, let's say, the current issues that have to be discussed when we talk about the state of democracy are captured by both the positive trends I will refer to as the negatives. The positive trends in the spread of democracy, well, we can just tick the boxes, and then we see, and I think you referred to it, we have an enormous part, a very important part of the number of member states of the United Nations that currently hold on a frequent basis elections. Whether the quality of the electoral processes always legitimize the fulfillment of the definition of democracy so that the control of the public authority, the exercise of public authority is through the citizens and that all citizens are equal in monitoring the exercise of public authority is another part, but when you tick the boxes, one should indeed see that we are having elections in more than ever countries. I think currently 114 to 116 of the 190 and so members of the United Nations. And you see the number, it has increased at a certain number, at a certain moment, and it's, well, it's almost all the almost all the countries, or in one way or another, currently could argue that they hold elections for legislative parliament, for legislative meetings, legislative elections. We will come back later on this kind of curb and the moment, the timeline, the moment when this curb tended to stabilize. So many elections, that means that from a world population from approximately 6 to 7 billion. Currently, more than, well, almost half of these people, of course, the adult people, are registered voters. So you see that there was a very important increase in the last, 20 years. If you add to this one a country like China, for instance, and some other non-democracies that even proclaim not to be a democracy, you see that the other part, the countries that really have a democratic system and that have registered voters, is indeed the number is very, very high. So in the positive trends in the spread of democracies, let's put this in a more perspective in terms of time, and we can say that the 20th century was basically the breakthrough of the democracies with, you know, the three waves. With the most interesting one to study, I think, is the third wave. The third wave that at a certain moment, certainly with the collapse of the Soviet system, the breakdown of the Iron Curtain, and then the end of apartheid, there was a kind of feeling that we were living the end of history and that the battle for which system of governance was won by the liberal democracy and that now we just would have to complete the exercise and that the whole of the world would be ruled based on representative democracy. And you see a number of countries that are still, and that became a democracy, multi-party democracy since the 70s, that are still strong democracies. You see them there in the lines on the slide. Since then, we know that, developments have stabilized. To say that there is a fourth wave would be too positive when we see that the Arab Spring failed to deliver as opposed to what was hoped for. We have some exceptions. We have some recent new nations where elections are held, like Myanmar, for instance. But to summarize, we had three waves in the 20th century, and now we're kind of blocked at the current number of democracies. I already told you that there are different aspects to democracy. This means that there are also different criteria based on which one can assess the quality of democracy. And one of the most known exercises is the one performed by Freedom House. Freedom House, which is an NGO, US-based, that, starting from very specific criteria, assesses the extent to which people are experiencing freedom as a citizens. And of course, having the right to vote, to criticize leadership, is, and the freedom of expression, freedom of media, is very key. And you see there, the green is part of the globe where all the, where there is freedom, where there is real freedom. The yellow is partly free, and the how do you say that? The fuchsia is the not free. And you see in the not free that there's still a long way to go to have, let's say, a reasonable level of freedom. But still, progress has been made. Progress has been made also when we look at, for instance, the willingness of citizens to live in a democratic nation. I think it's fair to say that although we sometimes have setbacks and sometimes we see developments stopped or even a reverse development, reverse evolution, the willingness of people to live in a democratically ruled country tends to be all over the globe, in most of the countries, most of the nations, still tends to be very strong, especially then within citizens, or driven by citizens' movements and civil society organizations. Be it Hong Kong, be it in the Arab world, we still see, I would say, on a weekly basis, you still see movements, you still see events where people in the non-free world try to argue for their freedom, to argue including for their freedom to vote for their leaders, to have a real fully-fledged democracy. Another example of progress is the number of constitutions that currently presently includes guarantees of gender equality. You would say, well, this is not more than normal. Well, I was recently in Montreal, and there a student, when we were discussing Arab Spring, he said, well, it took you how many decades in Switzerland to grant voting rights to women? And of course, this is a very specific case, but still, I think for young people, it should be known that, for instance, constitutions granting voting rights and also the right to be elected is quite a recent phenomenon, and there had to be a fight to come to that stage of development. And of course, there's still a lot to do to have real inclusiveness for women, to have an equal access to politics, and to have a balanced representation, gender-based. We hosted last week a meeting with the speaker of the Rwandese parliament, a woman, and Rwanda is one of the outperformers in terms of balanced, gender-based, balanced parliaments, but it's an exception. In Europe, for the moment, it's 22% of the members of parliament that are women. In Rwanda, it's something like 50%. You have some Latin American countries also with very close to 50%, but still this is a goal to work to. But on the other hand, constitutions already guarantee gender equality in terms of access to voting rights and to the rights of being represented. So as a consequence, then, of course, a greater participation representation of women. A very important event in terms of positive trends supporting democratic governance was the adoption last year of the 2030 Agenda. I think that's for you as a generation that will become professionally active, and also from an academic point of view, the majority of you, academically speaking, active, this was a very important breakthrough. Was not easy to achieve, but where, on the one hand, the Millennium Development Goals were really focused on, I would say, the development aid aspects, trying to help people, the third world, to bring these parts of the globe to a sustainable level of, to a better level of socioeconomic development and of, let's say, availability of collective services and natural resources and water and so on, and sanitation and healthcare. Now the SDGs are intended to support trends and to have improvements in all, including, not the least, so-called developed nations, and there the fact that in the 17 goals 17 is more than the MDGs, but in the 17 SDGs, that at least two of these goals are very closely linked to the quality of democracy, to democracy as such, but to the quality of democracy is also very important to know for future debates and for future, I would say, including academic research in the course of the next 15 to 20 years. Although, to be fair and honest, the word democracy is not included in the SDGs. That was a bridge too far, which also shows that notwithstanding all these positive trends, the state of democracy today is that there are still some member states of the United Nations that oppose the inclusion of democratic governance as a goal that is linked to the fairness, to human rights, to fundamental human rights. And these countries that oppose, they manage to have a formula, a wording of SDG 5 and particularly SDG 16, referring to accountability and to the quality of the institutions, so to say, characterizing real important criteria, parts, aspects of democracy without naming the D word. That's the kind of compromise. But we were very happy with that compromise because this is a very important tool for the future action to improve democratic governance. It's the fact that now that it is agreed in the United Nations that in terms of gender equality, goal 5, in terms of accountability of leadership of authorities, goal 16, these are included in the sustainable development goals that have to be pursued, have to be achieved as good as possible by member states of the United Nations, which means that they have to show to the United Nations what kind of national implementation plans they have, how they will, on a national level, how they will improve the accountability, which is, of course, a very accountability of public authority towards citizens, which is, of course, very close to the core, to the essence of democratic governance. Last but not least, we see positive trends in the devolution of power, in the decentralization and the multi-level governance. When we look at the institutional landscape, we see that very important parts of this, these institutions, politically speaking, in their functioning, are meeting lots of challenges. When you look at global governance, there's a lack of inclusive global governance. There's a lack of empowerment of decisions of global inclusive institutions. When we look at nations today, there are lots of the concept of nation is to a certain extent subject to a crisis, an existential crisis. But we see also positive trends where, for instance, metropolitan area, where in a couple of decades the vast majority of citizens will live in, we see at that level a lot of innovation, creativity, to try to bridge the gap, to bridge the gap between citizens and then, in that case, the local or the regional governance. So this decentralization, this multi-level governance, is perceived by us as a positive development. Of course, the exercise of this multi-level governance is sometimes difficult. In this country, we know what it means. But still, from a global perspective, it's very important to have this, to have checks and balances, to have a dynamic approach, a tailor-made approach also that comes close to the typically regional and local problems, and to have responsive public authorities that try to innovate besides the constitutional setup, besides the institutions we know, that try to innovate to improve the legitimacy and to improve the interaction with their citizens. So very important for the future is the developments in decentralization and the multi-level governance. But there's also the flip side. It is, of course, not all positive. Well, at the contrary. And so I would like to point at some, negative developments, and then we will see what root causes are or what kind of responses could be thought of when we try to tackle these negative developments, these challenges of development of democracy. Number one, and this is for the average citizen and for the average observer, is something which is sometimes hard to appropriate. Of course, we know it from a rational point of view. We know that democratic progress is not always linear, that you sometimes have setbacks, and that sometimes the situation is improving, and then after some years there is a more negative trend. Democratic progress is sometimes subject to stalling, to reversal. But it's good to know that. Well, take an example not so far from let's say, the core of the European Union. When we look at what we call the wider Central European and Eastern European countries, we've seen the implosion of the Soviet system, the Comecon, the zone of influence of the former Soviet Union, and you saw this breakthrough of liberal democracies. Well, in some countries, some of these countries, some aspects of the freedom of expression, freedom of speech, the quality of representation, the respect public authorities tend to show for basic human and fundamental rights tend not to have improved, and the rule of law and other aspects are sometimes challenged. So very important to know, it's not the kind of dynamics that was kind of experienced and people felt until in the 90s, so step by step the whole of the world would increasingly come under the governance of democratic, on the rulership of democratic systems. No, there are setbacks, and some countries are suffering from that. Take another example. I think Venezuela currently is a nice example. Well, nice. It's an example of a country that had a pathway to democracy, to democratic governance, and at a certain moment, you see that Chavismo, and then what came after, that it developed in another way, giving even tensions as we speak today. The voter turnout, we just saw the rise in registered voters. This slide, which is a bit like a test for the ophthalmologist, but I will explain. This slide shows that there is, generally speaking, volatility for some parts of the globe. When you add democracies and elections in Africa, for instance, you see a rise of the number of people participating in electoral processes. But what is a bit embarrassing is that the, so to say, traditional democracies, the older, deeply rooted democracies, that they suffer from indifference by their citizens, by their voters. This goes for Europe. It also goes, of course, for the US. Mr. Trump, I think 2 weeks ago, was elected by not only a close to majority of voters, but it still was a minority. But I think it was something like 25-26% only of the citizens of the United States, because of this indifference, people being fed up with the political system, not using their voters' rights. And so this adds to this what we see, that this fact that there is, notwithstanding an increase in registered voters, that we see a decrease in participation. This is, of course, key, and this comes back later. The essence of the problem we are facing is, after some decades, after more than 100 years of development, breakthrough of democracy based on representation, based on multi-party system, on elections, electoral processes, that you see that an increasing part of the population, including younger people, are kind of taking their distances and tend to be indifferent to the whole of the electoral process. This is very important to be aware of, because, of course, in terms of democratic governance, the free choice of people to appoint, to elect their leaders and to hold them accountable, this is comes close to the core of the definition we explained at the beginning. I already mentioned the democratic setbacks and gave the example of Venezuela. Very sorry for if there are Venezuelans in the room. Second, very at current times, very debated development is the rise of populism. It would lead us too far to make a distinction between the real populism, in accordance to the scientific definitions we use, and then the, let's say, the political movements that tend to use very, how do you call this, demagogic populist arguments. But still, the fact is that, especially in Europe and the US, we have a rise of this simple solution approaches, post-reality approaches that kind of capture not then the indifference, but the negative feelings of the population that confirm negative trends in the hearts and minds of the population. I try to capture by saying we are outsiders and we will change the whole system. We will bring results without any more taking into account fundamental rules about facts, truth, or the principles of representative democracy. I already mentioned the antagonism, as it was pictured by Mr. Friedman, and I think it was in the New York Times, the web people and the wall people, this social polarization, not only between the haves and have-nots, the people that draw benefit from globalization, free markets, the economic growth, not only between the haves and have-nots from that point of view, but also the people that tend to understand the new ways based on which societies are organized, and the ones that don't understand, the people that can participate, and the people that feel themselves as left over. Migration is also an important issue that is underlying this social polarization. This is, of course, a negative trend, which makes it more difficult for democratic institutions to function in a very normal way. Intensification of conflict, the comeback of geopolitics and the spread of terrorism worldwide. I would say that terrorism is an example where external events are internalized through the pressure they put on the institutions, including on the democratic institutions. So the intensification of conflict, the spread of terrorism have, of course, a very negative impact on the quality and the soundness of the political debate within a democratic governance. Then more local, of course, I could mention issues of peace building in the whole Arab world, but I chose to just to refer to Colombia. It's another part of the globe. Of course, setbacks to peace building are also a source of negative trends in the spread of democracy. Very importantly, to give you another source of concern, is the whole cluster of direct democracy in trying to overcome the crisis of representation, the crisis in the legitimacy of the mandate and the credibility of the mandate given to people to decide based on that mandate on behalf of citizens, part of the answer given by political leadership is to organize referendums around crucial questions. Sometimes it's based on tradition, and it's also, let's say, a normal part of the democratic life of a country. Switzerland is a nice example of that. But still, putting this aside, we can say that in some countries that are referred to there, you have referendum used as a tool, but at the end of the day, you see that referendum gives the wrong answer to the right question or the right answer to the wrong question. Anyway, there is a lack of enough matching capacity between what a referendum puts forward as a problem to solve and to ask the opinion of the people for, and on the other hand, what comes out of this referendum. We have to be very careful there, of course, because when people decide to leave the European Union after a referendum in a majority, when people decide not to agree with a draft peace agreement, or when people have a different view than the leadership concerning a particular issue like in Hungary, this doesn't mean that democracy doesn't function. The problem is that obviously the answer given and the outcome is not always in accordance to what the so quote-unquote political will of the majority really was. Other negative trend is that we see as a reaction to violence, as a reaction to the pressure on institutions, that in some regimes, leadership tends to take measures to shrink the space for civil society and restrictions. We have some very well thought through pieces by colleagues, Tom Carotas, for instance, about the shrinking space for civil society to defend democracy. Tunisia is another example of a country where at a certain moment there is a bomb attack, and as a reaction, the leadership, narrows the space for civil society. We had a debate last year and the year before in France, in Belgium also, about after the terrorist attacks, what is the right balance between freedom of expression and movement, and on the other hand, guaranteeing security of our citizens. And so in lots of places all over the globe, you see that the conclusion of that exercise, the impact of that exercise, is from a practical point of view, is narrowing, shrinking the space for defending democratic governance and defending democracy as a good concept to govern society. Just from what we are currently doing as a management of International ID, we had with some colleagues of other institutions a couple of weeks ago a discussion about Egypt, for instance. Egypt, an enormous country, a very vast country in size, in geopolitical importance, and also in number of people living there, and a very young population. There is there now a very strong, I would say, close to autocratic regime, and legislation was approved last week with as an impact, intended or not, to shrink the margins for NGOs, but also for international organizations to be active in that country, to support democracy, I would say not fighters, but people that try to improve democracy, that want to do, for instance, capacity building for civil society, to hold the leaders accountable, to support political parties, to be critical towards the leadership. Legislation was passed through to limit the possibilities. The same goes for Russia, but in Egypt, for instance, last week, we decided just to close our office. We were one of the rare institutions still having an office there that was supporting parliament, that was supporting the election commission. But for security reasons, and mostly because the space to really be active in an independent and free way through the new legislation is becoming too narrow. Very importantly, of course, a negative trend is the failure of the Arab Spring. I think the responsibility is shared. And I think the way that the West handled the Iraq crisis, and afterwards what we did in Libya, has certainly made it more difficult, has certainly negatively impacted on the geopolitical situation, but also on how, on the domestic scene in these countries, the political debate went on. But fact is, more globally speaking, that in the whole of the Arab world, and it goes even quite far in geographic terms from the one side, Northern Africa, through let's say very close to Central Asia, we see the failure of this so-called Arab Spring. There are some rare exceptions. Tunisia is still some fragile, but it's still an exception to the very difficult situation. Morocco, step by step. But from a more global point of view, the other countries, most of the other countries, still suffer from a lack of freedom of expression, of just peaceful conditions. There is extreme violence. And so when you think about 2011, 2012, what was the hope then for the whole of the Arab region? We are very far from home. Very important in terms of the assessment of democracy as a problem solver, as a peaceful problem solver, and as a way to deliver for the citizens and for the population is the success of autocratic, pragmatic regimes. To make it quite simple, I was recently in India. When you talk to students in India, and they have to balance the deeply rooted democratic culture in the biggest democracy of the world and the economic outcome, the delivery or the lack of delivery and the inequalities, and when they compare from a theoretical point of view but also from a practical point of view with the outcome of the pragmatic, let's say, non-democratic leadership in China, people are discussing this, and what goes for India certainly goes for a continent where there is an increasing Chinese influence in Africa, on the African continent. The African continent, which is of crucial importance for our small European, Western European peninsula. So the success of autocratic, pragmatic regimes certainly makes it more difficult for political leaders, for people defending democracy, to argue for democratic governance as the best and most sustainable way in the long term to bring results, to spread economic growth, to distribute wealth, and to bring better life conditions to people. This is very crucial on the African continent. I think in Asia it depends on other issues. Latin America is more or less stabilized, but the African continent, which is the number one challenge in terms of possible progress in terms of democratic governance with lots of successes. Well, on the African continent is, this issue of the success of autocratic, pragmatic regimes is certainly felt very intensely. When we then try to come to some, more societally linked and not geographically linked and not historically linked issues, of challenges to democracy building, the state of democracy building today, I would say that not to underestimate others, but these are some of the five, six top issues we urgently have to be aware of and have to try to internalize and have to try to tackle in the practice of democracy. The number one is to be very well aware of the negative impact of over-promising and under-delivering. So the delivery gap, the gap between electoral promises and, at the end of the day, delivery, is certainly, including a new democracy, so-called new democracy, is really something that should be worked on. We should find systems to limit the capacity for people to promise heaven and then to bring a democratic system in crisis, because after a couple of years, people feel that, the new elected leaders just have been lying and that there is no delivery. This is essential to the quality of legitimacy through governance. So the delivery gap is certainly a top issue in terms of the crisis of representation, in terms of the challenges to democracy building. Number two is what I call the uberization. The change in interaction between offer and demand with much more horizontality, much more speed, and more volatility. This is really a dramatic change in lots of domains in society. Uber, of course, refers to not the public transport, but the urban transport system, with this role of taxis, and then Uber that comes with using the ICT application and devices to break through and to make the services of cars with drivers more accessible. But what happened in this area is now spreading in all kinds of other economic domains. And very typically, and to summarize, is the so-called 4D. The 4Ds, where at least three are really fundamental and which we, until now, we haven't internalized in the thinking about how to organize democracy. It's the digitalization, the disruptive innovation, and the disintermediation. Deflation is something a bit apart. I will just use a couple of words later. But digitalization, disruptive innovation, and disintermediation, this is what's happening. It's part of the story of real life, of the economy. If a couple of weeks ago, I think it was ING that decided to close lots of banking, well, that's due to that. I mean, there's a digitalization through which the bank services are offered through internet. There is a disruptive innovation because we are paperless and directly connected to bank services, to the people that offer these bank services. And last but not least, very importantly, when we talk about representative democracy, is this disintermediation. In most of the domains in public space, and even in private space, you can now very easily access. You can, in a very horizontal, very spontaneous and rapid way, access the people that have something to offer to you. And these people, are, of course, encouraged to offer you in a much horizontal, in a much easy-to-access way. The political system is currently still a bit standing aside. It's one of the only ones. The other domains of the real and economic life are already using digitalization, have had these disruptive innovations, and have had, to a very important degree, the disintermediation that is typically a development also that will take place in the future. Disruptive innovation, that's clear. For instance, when we traveled, we used to use a map, and now we just put our GPS or our app system. Disintermediation, I already gave the example of a bank, but it's also the case in contacts. You know, you can integrate in debates, plug in through social media in debates, and you can also buy a book and have it delivered at your home. Buying it almost directly, asking at the publisher to send it through Amazon. And this is something where politics, because of its essence, representative democracy, is lagging behind. And you feel a kind of tension there between the citizens and all these processes around politics and not happening, not implemented in politics. I think this is really a very important element. Deflation is more about the last well, not maybe the last 10, 15 years, but before, since the Second World War, we typically had quite a good economic growth with a bit of inflation, and it gave a socio-economic development scheme where there was a welfare state built up, there was debt to encourage investment, made it accessible also for people to have real estate. And since inflation is down now, since we have a kind of, it's not really deflation, but very close to, since economic growth is more coming back to the normal, you see that our political systems, based on based on vision and a more inclusive world and a more equally distributed wealth, were based on this, certainly since the Second World War, on this always, at least marginally, but most of the times more than marginally, increase of wealth. For instance, the breakthrough of democracy in Latin America was certainly linked to this mutual reinforcement of, on the one hand, democratic breakthroughs and the capacity for the people elected based on this democratic breakthrough to distribute wealth, to have a more equal access for people to education, to health services. This is kind of stopped because of this monetary necessity and also the lack of enough economic growth due to all causes. I won't elaborate on that. This wouldn't need a couple of hours. But it's one of the four Ds that have not been internalized by the political system until now. When I started politics in Belgium, I remember that my first important position, I became a secretary general of my party. And then for my then president, who was Mr. Van Rompuy, the Sunday evening we used when the family was watching, I don't know what kind of film in the evening, we used to sit aside and then to call each other and to say, Herman, what do you think? What is on the agenda for next week? What should we discuss tomorrow morning on the, Parteibureau, the party leadership? And then we discussed, and I had the Sunday evening to prepare and to call some people to say, could you intervene tomorrow? And that was the start of a political week. And all of the media system and the debate system was based on that kind of assessment, the Sunday evening, what has been happening during the last 3 to 4 days, what is in the newspapers, what should we answer, to what kind of questions citizens have, should we formulate an answer. And then we started the Monday, we had our party meetings, we had conclusions, we made a communique, as they called it, we made a press release to tell to the world how we were thinking about whatever subject. Then on Tuesday, we would explain to our parliamentary groups what we had decided on Monday, to say, well, colleagues, dear friends from our party, this is why we think this is the way to solve this problem. Then on Wednesday, there would be parliamentary activities, commissions. Then Thursday, you would have the same issues debated in question time in Parliament. Well, and then you would have the newspapers of Friday and the interviews of the Saturday, and you could have one day of relief. And the Sunday evening, you had to go back to sit aside. This was the way political debate was going on until half the 90s and close to the end of the 20th century. It was fundamentally still based on what used to be the 19th century situation. Well, this has dramatically changed because of the impact of these 3 to 4 Ds, the 3 Ds. We have a global news world with instant horizontal communication. When a Sunday afternoon WikiLeaks, or what is it, brings to the evidence that X persons have put their money into tax havens and have tried to avoid taxation in a at least ethically not defendable way, Monday morning, less than 12 hours afterwards, the Prime Minister of Iceland had to resign. And then the Monday and the Sunday evening even, world leaders had to address the issue. And then 2 or 3 days after would be something else. So this rhythm of development, and politics is about presenting options to people to address challenges. And the agenda setting of challenges has dramatically changed, developed. And the problem is that we are still managing politics the way we used to do it when history was unfolding at a very lower pace. I tend to summarize, but it's a bit a populist approach. I think that to a certain extent in Western Europe, we are still performing politics and still have a political engagement based on 19th century ideologies, using 20th century tools, think of the mass political parties, trying to address most of the times new problems that have been rising through the last couple of decades. So trying to solve 21st century challenges using the 20th century decision-making tools with our political parties, with very, difficult decision-making, and most of the time is based on the socialist approach, collectivist approach, the more liberal, individual-empowering approach, Christian, democratic, nationalist, all these ideologies that basically have their roots in the 18th, 19th century. This is really confronted with this dramatic, disruptive change. This is one of the main challenges. Just to give you an anecdote, when the last time we had to vote in Belgium, I was sitting on the coach with my second son, who is now 27. He was then, I think, 24, 25. And I said, Thomas, you will go to vote tomorrow. He said, yes. Why do you have to sermon me? Why do you have to teach me? Don't be too concerned. I will go to vote, and I will vote for your friends. No problem. I'm convinced, and so on. But then he added, but think about this, Ad. I'm doing my accounting for my company. He has a little company. And I'm doing this now online. And you ask me to wait for 4 years. Every 4 years, I'm invited to go to my former school in a place that I know because I was a kid there, and to put a ballot in a box and then to wait a couple of years to say again whether I was okay, whether I found it fine, the way these people that I voted for, whether I find it fine that the way they handled that mandate, the way they performed. And he said, this is not the way society is to be organized. And I think he's right. The problem is that an alternative for this structured, well-organized approach is not easy to find. There's a necessity to re-engineer, and this is one of the most impressive challenges, this model of representative democracy that is questioned. Last but not least on that slide, the shrinking margin of political discretion. On the other hand, expectations that are very high because there is a lack of delivery and there is frustration. Every politician that is honest, and Obama was really recently very honest on that issue, will tell you that the impact of the personal decision-making of one politician apart, be it even the President of the United States, has been shrinking during the last decades because of multi-level, multinational, global governance, because of the fact that politics has pulled out of very important domains of activities. Think about all these public enterprises. Think about the breakthrough of the internal market. So the impact, the role of political leadership has been shrinking. And on the other hand, they have increasingly to be very promising, have increasingly to put forward very attractive promises because there's an increase of competition and people are increasingly indifferent to politics. So this is a kind of mutually reinforcing dynamics, which is very difficult to break, but is part of this negative, this challenge to democracy. I will go a little bit faster because otherwise we run out of time. There is, of course, the migration with the reaction of citizens, which is changes always a bit, creating defensive reactions. Important for us to know that we are a small European peninsula on the Asian giant where 50% of the world population lives, and located geographically above the ticking bomb of Africa. I mean ticking bomb. It's a demographic, very impressive development on the African continent. So we should know that migration, immigration in Europe is there to stay. And there's no way out of it. There's no alternative. I mean, we cannot even have a Trumpian approach. We cannot even say we will build walls. Europe is as it is not a continent that you can rule by closing the doors, putting iron curtains. But still this, unavoidable phenomenon of increasing migration is, of course, putting pressure on democracy. We already have been referring to direct democracy and representative democracy, the tensions and the limited, qualitatively limited impact of direct democracy, the inequality that leads to insecurity. There is the issue of youth and intergenerational challenge. What is the position of young people? How do they look at this kind of inherited institutions from former generations? There is the issue of global governance, the lack of democracy, or at least the feeling that there is a lack of democracy in this global supranational governance that sometimes has real impact on the daily life of people. There is, of course, the consumerism, that people look at politics as a shopping exercise. What's in for us? What is the product that is available at the lowest price? What does it bring to me, apart from an ideological or principally-based view? Indifference, we already pointed at that. Very briefly to conclude, and I hope I have brought some stuff for questions and for thinking. What do we do then? Briefly, IDEA is an intergovernmental organization that was created 21 years ago. We currently have 29 member states on 6 continents. It's very important. It's a global footprint with, I refer to the definition, with all kinds of democracies, with very different experiences of democracies, partly also because it's not only a global footprint, it's also a membership that is composed of democracies of totally different sizes, with India the biggest one, but also with democracies like Cabo Verde, Barbados. It's also an institution with membership with very wealthy nations of the so-called deeply rooted democracy, like Australia, Canada, Sweden, Norway, Germany, Belgium, also the Netherlands, but also with countries that are still fighting for their future from an economic point of view, like Ghana, like Botswana, like India, like Indonesia, the Philippines. This horizontal characteristic is very important, once again, because we don't estimate, we don't start from the point of view that we have the mature democracy and that other countries all over the globe should, where we should teach them how to behave and we should export democracy to them. Once again, democracy can, to our opinion, only be supported and not exported. We are a small organization. We have something like 180, 190 staff with a budget delivered by our member states, which makes it possible to have some activities. We have a headquarter in Stockholm, but we have representative offices, one in Brussels, one in New York, regional offices and so on, some country offices. Programmatic activities in 71 countries. Very importantly, what we do in terms of substance is, or in terms of activities first, is we perform research. Research that we bring to the people in different forms, very traditional through books, handbooks, reports that are printed documents. I think there are some, Andrew, at the entrance. Number two can also be managing websites where you can find all the evidence about elections. If you would like to know in 1964 how many people participated in the elections, I don't know where. Well, you go on the websites, you will find it, or what part of the parliament is female in Australia or whatever. You can find it on these websites we cater for together with colleagues. So producing sources of knowledge, always for free. So our member states ask us to only produce public goods. So when you look on our websites and you find a book of interest for you, just send a mail and it will be shipped to you for free. So I think we cannot be more accessible than that. The website, you just ask for a document and you will be sent it. Of course, you have to wait a couple of days. We are not Amazon, but we try to be effective in bringing it as soon as possible to you. So only publishing public goods, but that research activity is very important. I think we have some 35 to 40 researchers in Stockholm researching all aspects of democracy. Number two is that we organize events and platforms for dialogue, sometimes with the community of research in certain areas. For instance, the role of money in politics is one area where the last couple of years we invested a lot in bringing together centers of expertise, working together with the OECD, working together with other institutions to bring together the best specialists to draft policy advice, to try to influence the debate. Last but not least, absorbing more than half of our human resources and to a very large extent also with lots of financial resources, a very important part of our financial resources is country assistance. We always, with the agreement or on the explicit demand of the leadership of a country, we go to countries and try to support democratic processes, legitimacy-reinforcing processes, capacity building for civil society, for minority groups, gender-promoting programs, and so on. So this is the kind of things we are doing. We are active then in four areas of expertise. It's IDEA, so it's about electoral assistance. That's because the number one issue we work on is electoral processes. I think, and I've been in politics since 25, 30 years, I think in terms of electoral processes, not electoral observation, but in terms of the technicalities, all aspects of the electoral cycle, I think really that IDEA is cutting-edge world leader in terms of producing knowledge about all kinds of aspects of the electoral process as such. We are not only producing research, we're also building, designing tools to protect, for instance, the integrity of the electoral processes, the security issues that go together with elections, and so on. The number two is constitution-building processes. Not so much the logistics, that's the Venice Commission, but more the processes, the procedures along which constitutions are built or changed or modified. Number three, increasingly important, is the whole of the domain of this interaction between citizen and political leadership, what to do with a capacity building in terms of the civil society, political parties, other forms of representation. Last but not least, the fourth item, which is also linked to the presence in our membership of lots of countries that have important natural resources, it's the role of natural resources and the economy in the socio-economic development, the democracy also, as the best way to develop the potential of a country and spread the wealth. Then we have three cross-cutting research and action issues, diversity, gender, very importantly, and then, it's unluckily an increasingly important issue or domain. It's the issue of conflict and security. We have currently Sweden that will hold the presidency of the Security Council, and afterwards Netherlands will be in the seat, and so for these member states we produce interesting pieces of research and also policy proposals. For instance, the timing of elections is a new program we will invest in when Security Council people are talking about trying to solve extreme violence in a part of the globe. At the end of the day, if you believe in democratic governance, you should start to organize this democratic governance. But what is the right moment? So we're trying to fill that gap. I personally felt afterwards that when we decided with Belgium, for instance, to join forces to have a free airspace above Libya, afterwards, I think it would have been better if we also not only would have been talking about our F-16s and about our troops, if we would have had a couple of hours to debate about what comes next. Once weapons are not killing people anymore, how do you build up this society? So this is about what we do for our people in the Security Council. We publish a lot about possible solutions to the crisis representation. I bring them in a just anecdotal way. I already refer to education. We have some new programs for young people engaging in politics, for capacity building, self-assessments for society, state of democracy exercises, state of local democracy exercises. Number two, e-voting is increasingly important. How do you organize this? Can you guarantee the trust of people in the process? For us, it seems to be logical, but in Belgium, we have a mixed system, and we have a quite an old democracy, but I can tell you when in Kyrgyzstan or in Mongolia, for instance, to new democracies, you organize elections and you use electronic voting systems or an electronic way to count votes, it's very important to work very hard on measures to have the people trusting the system and to trust the outcome. Because otherwise, the legitimacy of these democracies is just challenged, and it's already quite a difficult part of the globe. The investing in the concept of netizens, of people that through the internet can implement their can use their rights to influence the political decision making. Very much used in Germany for the moment is for the political party system to organize a feedback by their members, not only based on just meetings they organize every X weeks, but through ICT tools to have a permanent dialogue with the membership or the people that support the party or the political people in charge. For instance, in the campaign, the recent campaign in France by François Fillon, this is a system that has been used a lot, drafting a program, starting up political activity about themes is to have on a permanent basis interaction with feedback from the people you tend to try to represent. Participatory budgeting is very much used in metropolitan areas now. It's also an example where you can have maybe a better involvement by people. Of course, the capacity to do that in real time is limited, but in lots of places now you see that local authorities say, well, we have this kind of budget for improving, for instance, security in an area. We will discuss with people how to use this money and how they think it would be best to use it in the area. Mandatory voting is very sensitive, but we think that to a certain extent, in some cases, reintroducing or introducing mandatory voting is a way to have people more engaged in the political process. The people's assemblies, it's based on lottery or based on spontaneous, let's say, initiative. It's bringing together people at a certain stage of decision-making, not only representatives, not only people that are elected, but just people that want to be active on the local level or the national level, that want to give a view, have an impact. These people's assemblies in Belgium, there are some attempts to do that. Of course, the role of civil society, we do a lot. Electoral platforms, trying to support the idea of the programmatic aspect of elections, that it's not only about persons, about people. It is, of course, about personalities and about the pros and cons of persons and the way they behave, the points of view they bring, but it's also about having substantial electoral platforms. That means common endeavor, common interests shared by members of a political party and based on which they support candidates for the elections. Public scrutiny of bills is another way in some countries. It's in the whole of the process of legislative assemblies to have a moment where bills are checked by the public opinion, where people can spontaneously react and give their view. It's close to referendum, but it's not really a referendum. The conditionality of public funding of political parties. The majority of these democracies that we refer to at the beginning have, to a certain extent, public funding for the activity of their political activities as a party or as a candidate, will make it conditional that, for instance, they have to prove that they invest in education, in training, and so on, which is also the last example of things we are working on. We are also trying to share on a website, which is also open for you, for instance, to see how political parties can organize themselves to become digital parties, to use the best methods to interact with the members and the non-members. This is very important in Europe, for instance. We have an implosion of membership of political parties. The Parti Socialiste in France, which is leading de facto the sixth most important economy in the world, only has something like 150,000 members at this moment. When you know that there are 36,000 municipalities, of course very small ones also, this is really an implosion of membership in that case. And it's not only isolated, it's not only the Parti Socialiste in France, it's all parties, most of the parties, all over the place. And so the distinction between a party member and a non-member with primaries is diluting. How do you use modern tools to fill that gap, and so on and so on. Maybe important is in September we will present a kind of yearbook about the state of democracy worldwide, focusing on some issues. It's maybe an occasion to have a new interaction with your students, madam. And you see other examples. I won't elaborate on them. But these are examples of tools we use to improve the quality of democracy. I stop here because otherwise I would really abuse of the time. As said before, I'm open to questions that you would think maybe he knows a piece of an answer on this one. But thank you for your attention. Thank you for listening to me. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much for your very rich lecture. And what I really appreciated is that you tried to go into the definitions and also to provide concrete examples and concrete problems. So it was really appreciated. I'm sure that our students learned a lot from your presentation. What is also interesting for the audience, at least for the students, is that you, of course, learn about democracy and democratization idea, international idea, is one of the actors which is involved in this process. So this is also an interesting point of view and a part or something which can be added to what you see in your classes with your professors. So I'm sure you have a lot of questions. I don't want to talk too much, so the floor is to who wants to raise the first question. I already see there. Yeah. Could you please introduce yourself?
Sorry?
Could you please introduce yourself and then ask
yes.
your question?
Francesco De Angelis. I was director a couple of years ago in the commission dealing with implementation of program project for human rights, rule of law, good governance, electoral observation, international. I think I am very pleased to see again Karin Fogg after so many years.
You sit far from each other.
Mr. Prime Minister, let me call you that like that. Apart from your obligation to introduce your idea, which is an institution obligation for you, concerning your speech, let me suggest to you, if allow me, that you start with second part of your speech, much more innovative, much more exciting, and then if you have time, then you talk about the first part, which is institutional, is more classic, I would say. It was very exciting to hear you in the last part of your speech. But I would like to make one question very short. I miss in your speech any reference to environment. Human rights, I would say that the one most important human rights is to live in a natural ecosystem, not damaged by human behaviors and caused by governments, and multinational, which really in the last time caused a real problem of really existence of people. You know that international society talks about to introduce crime of ecocides and give the competence to the International Criminal Court. So I wonder why in your speech there is no reference at all of this dramatic problem, which is a real human rights, right, I would say so, let me repeat the concept. So I would suggest that the idea would, treat this aspect very seriously and in depth. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I propose to collect other questions, if you agree,
okay.
Two or three questions. I already saw, okay. So first you and then the third one, okay.
Hello, I'm a student in political science in general orientation, and I also a Belgian citizen, so I know your political career. First, I would like to thank you for your presentation. It was clear and very interesting. But I would like to come back to your definition of democracy and the definition of democracy. You're saying that this definition is a very large definition, and I agree with the fact that it's very difficult to define this concept, but I personally don't think this definition is actually large. The last part is very interesting for us, and we can opposite it with a very recent event, and you're talking about in your presentation. I'm talking about the U.S. presidential election, where Mr. Trump wins with less vote than his opponent, Ms. Clinton. Furthermore, the U.S. electoral system allowed this election twice since the beginning of 21st century. This Trump election could happen because some votes, citizens are more or less important, depending where they live. So we can say that the U.S. electoral system is unequal, who is not in agreement with this ID definition if we say that election is a people-controlled exercise of government. So the question is quite surprising, but the question is, can we and your institution qualify the United States of America as a democracy with this point of view?
Thank you for your question. The third one.
Thanks. I'm a PhD student from ULB and working in the political science. And my PhD is funded by the Chinese government scholarship, and a topic is democracy and also terrorism regions immobilization system. So my question is very short and very simple. Could you tell me the relationship between the democracy and industrialization or the modernization? That's my question.
This first round, please.
Good afternoon. I'm a former student of European Affairs of the Catholic University of Leuven, and I have two short questions. The first one concerns the state of democracy in Africa and sub-Saharan Africa. You gave us a general overview of the state of democracy in the world, and I would like to ask you, which are the countries which made most of the progress in the African continent, which are the countries with the biggest drawbacks, and try to explain us what are the main difficulties, what are the main explications of these differences between these countries in the African continent. The second question is about accountability in democracies in general. Because we can say that still now it's the politicians are accountable towards the citizens, especially during the elections. And I would like to ask you if, thanks to the new technologies, this process of accountability can be improved even after the elections, because, as you said, we're running our political system with methods that are very old, and if you think, what can be the solution to this problem? Thank you.
We have 5 questions, so I propose to stop here and collect other sets a bit later.
It's here. I was looking for the mic. Thank you very much for the questions. Maybe the first one on climate change. The strategy of an institution like International ID is based on a discussion with member states. We are currently implementing a strategy that was decided in 2011-2012, and we are starting to discuss the new strategy, where we have a debate with our member states what is at stake in terms of democratic governance. Where should the promotion of democracy concentrate, focus on, and how to implement, and what resources, and so on. I would say a traditional strategic discussion. As far as climate change is concerned, I think the general feeling of member states, when we had discussions, and we had one recently, is that the issues of the impact of human activity on environment in terms of the use of natural resources and also of pollution and the consequence of human activity is one of the issues where ownership of the problem by citizens should indeed be increased in recognizing the problem, in the role the different partners in the process can play, and in monitoring the outcome, the lack of success or the success of measures. So the point of view of the member states is that it is indeed key, and to have a democratic governance of the whole of the climate change agenda. But some of the member states also argue that this is, based on the traditional thinking of we also have the right to develop our economy, and we have the right to develop it to a certain extent, like you did, there is a kind of resistance to make democratic governance and accountability the center in terms of implementation, the center of the discussion in the field of climate change. So this is a bit the tension we are working with within a constituency of member states, where we have countries like I refer to India, Mauritius, and others that are partly countries, member states that still have an enormous underdevelopment, or in some cases could suffer from the impact, or suffering currently from the impact of activity in what we call then the very developed world. So these discussions, certainly for a, to be frank and open, within an institution that is Nordic-based, Scandinavian-based, always tend to have a couple of sides around the table with countries that still are working towards more progress and more socio-economic development based on the use, indeed, of natural resources, but that want to have the right to use these resources, to collectively own them, but in terms of the limits to these activities and the limiting the impact, the negative impact on the environment, that want to have a very, I would say, balanced approach. And starting indeed from the fact that capacity building for citizens and ownership by the ordinary citizens of what should be done is key, but should not be given more importance than the attention for other issues they are still challenged by. So it's, I don't know if I'm clear enough, but that's the kind of way we have been advocating, including for the Marrakesh summit, that there would be more attention to the ownership, once again, by local authorities, by people, by civil society, of the measures, the decision-making about deciding on what tools to use to achieve the goals of climate change in terms of promotion of renewables, reduction of pollution, and so on. But it is still, there's still a lot of headway to achieve this. In terms of the question you, a bit provocatively, but that's good, you asked whether the US is a democracy. For us, it's essential that one woman, one man, one vote, that principle is core of the institutional setup and of the electoral process. The United States are not the only democracy where through the electoral, well, the way the electoral process is organized and the way political power is distributed, where there is a bit of a challenge put on this fundamental equality. I was spontaneously thinking about the Italian system, for instance, where the biggest party gets a kind of, supplementary bunch of seats in order to be able to have a big majority, enough to really rule the country, and where you could say that a voter for the PD in Italy has more rights than a voter for the opposition, just because his party or her party came the strongest out of the system. The UK has been ruled often by a minority of voters through the one-seat constituencies without a real dose of proportionality that would allow a more even and fair representation based more on the one man, one vote. So I think to summarize the response on your question, I think there should be indeed a good debate in the States about the equality of citizens to impact the elections. But personally, I think that the issue of money and the vested interest that bias the electoral democracy in the States is more urgent today than changing the system of indirect election or appointment of the president. Although you have a point, but that point is not specifically only a point for the U.S. Democracy. Even closer, for instance, in France, when you have in March the presidential elections, normally will be followed by legislative elections. Based on the electoral system in France today, I think you have one or two or three members of the Front National in the parliament, in the Chambre des députés, Assemblée nationale, sorry. You have two or three members of the Front National. Meanwhile, the Front National is close to be the in numbers of voters, the strongest political party. So I think it's we could not only point to the United States in terms of that issue. And personally, I would say concerning the fundamental need for having an equal right to influence, I think really the role of money and the biasing of the political agenda through vested interests, through donations for every 2 years for the member of parliament that has to be reelected so often, and then the presidential elections, I think there's a lot of space to for more urgent regulation. In terms of your question, if I understood the question well, and you should correct me if not, sorry. See, it's global. It's ICT. Our point is that in the long run, democratic governance is the most. Democratic governance in the long run has proven to be the most effective way if you want to have a, in the long term, sustainable economic development. This can be challenged, and there could be decades where, in a pragmatic way, countries manage, like China, for instance, to have an enormous performance in terms of socio-economic development. But to a certain extent, we think that in the long run, when you talk about decades and decades, a ownership of the process and influencing the process and legitimacy of the process through elections and through involvement of the population is really key. I would add that the situation is also not black and white. I mean, in your country, because I understand you're coming from China, you don't have real democracy, but you have also a kind of scrutiny by stakeholders at the local level or at in ministries or in parts of the economy where the way the leadership is exercised is kind of scrutinized. I would say that at the end of the day, of course, it's not a very, like we perceive democracy, it's not in that way that people are appointed or that people are not appointed or extended in their mandate, but still it's not black and white. There is also a kind of, scrutiny by members in by citizens in your country. But in the long run, we are believers in the content of the book of Acemoglu and Robinson, Why Nations Fail, the distinction between extractive systems and systems where there is an inclusive decision making. But once again, it's a very present debate at current stage of development of democracy. In terms of Africa, I don't know who asked the question. It's, of course, very difficult in 3 minutes to summarize. But we think that the overall development in Africa comprises some very positive aspects. Of course, all member states are fully-fledged democracies. In Africa, we have 6 or 7 member states. We have Ghana, with a very strong, for instance, shared ownership of natural resources management, alterning in terms of majority-minority. We have Namibia and Botswana, also fully-fledged democracy. Of course, in Namibia, there's the crisis of political parties you also find back in South Africa. I would say in South Africa, it's a little bit biased by facts about corruption and about not reaching the quality of governance one could expect. It's typically a bigger democracy that is looking for its second kind of dynamism. Kenya, Tanzania, Tunisia, we already referred. So there are good. Nigeria, for instance, a very peaceful transition we had. Benin, which will be a member state next month. So I think you have at least 20, 25 countries where democratic practice, peaceful transition from the one leadership to the other is taking place. Of course, there are other examples. Examples where, thanks to the population, less peaceful transitions are avoided, like Burkina Faso, for instance, or other examples where obviously there's a risk of tension related to democratic decision-making, like and this is sometimes related to the non-constitutional extension of mandates. I think the discussion in DRC is typically such a discussion. The vastness of the country is, of course, maybe also a source. I already referred to Egypt, where we have our office in Africa and Ethiopia. Obviously, there are problems more in the northern part of the countries, and then when you go further in Yemen, in of course South Sudan. So there are lots of countries, nations with huge problems, but the global picture is very nuanced, and we have some real countries where democracy has made progress. I don't cite all kinds of other countries like Senegal and others, which I could refer to. We have, by the way, some publications on specifically focusing on Africa, which we could share with you. But for instance, when you look at the map, you see that vast countries like Libya, Egypt, DRC, they of course fill this how do you call it, the fuchsia color. also countries like Rwanda, there are, but sometimes it's because they score very low on some aspects of democratic governance, like freedom of expression or freedom of or gender or LGBT rights. So there are different aspects. But I would say globally the picture is nuanced, and you have lots of countries where democracy is making progress. I'm now thinking about the last question, which was about accountability, but I don't remember exactly the wording of the question. Who asked? Yes, so what was your question again? I think crucial are at least 3 to 4 things. Number one is transparency in the most efficient way you could organize it. The more transparency you bring, I mean in terms of the use of taxpayers' money, the way decisions are taken, the more accountable a society will be. And this can be very practical. For instance, in the Ministry of Education of Brazil recently decided to put on a website and in real time all, openbare aanbesteding, all tendering processes, so that people can follow live how tenders are processed in the Ministry of Education, one of the most taxpayers' money-consuming ministry. So it's transparency, which is very crucial, but also the in electoral processes. What kind of people do we elect? Where does their wealth come from? To declare where the money comes from to campaign, that kind of transparency is key. Number two, I think it's strong and independent institutions that can act against infringement of laws and against fraud. Strong institutions, investing in the strength of these institutions, both in the part of the executive branch, but also in the judiciary, so that nobody feels as free to do whatever he or she wants, but that there is a control, that the people are monitored. So I think these are examples, there are more to give, of how you can strengthen accountability. We have some research papers on that. We can share them with you, and if you want, we can send them some. But there's certainly, throughout a legislature, and in a period of mandate, there are lots of ways to improve, to increase the real accountability. It's also, for instance, fact checks, trying to also to force people that stand for election to check the promises with, to have institutions that can tell people, educate people about what are the consequences of proposals that are made, and so on and so on.
Well, thank you very much for the answers. I'm afraid we cannot collect other questions because it is 4 o'clock and we know that you have classes and you have to leave. So thank you very much for your attention and thank you very much for your very rich and interesting lecture, Mr. Secretary General. Thank you.